In my video on how doctors paternalistically mislead patients about statin risks and benefits for their own good, I talk about how, for the majority of patients surveyed, the expectation of benefit from drugs like statins is higher than the actual benefit the drugs provide. So this creates tension between a patient's right to know and the likely reduction in the chance they'd agree to take it if they knew how little benefit the drug offered. On a population scale, that would be devastating. For example, statins probably prevent tens of thousands of deaths a year in the United States. However, if patients were routinely told the truth, as many as 75% of patients might stop treatment. So unless we keep everyone in the dark, 30,000 people could die. So what should doctors do? I agree with these doctors that we have to tell the truth, even if it means the patient doesn't take it and potentially dies as a result. It's their body, their choice. Of course, I wish this fully informed consent would extend to telling people about the beneficial role of a healthy diet, but before we get into that, let's answer the statins question. Are they worth it? Maybe you're in the 25% of people who would still take it, even knowing the whole truth. So what is the whole truth? We've all seen the drug ads, like this one touting atorvastatin, Lipitor, as reducing the risk of a heart attack by about a third. But as you can see in the small print, that means in a large clinical study, 3% of patients taking a sugar pill had a heart attack, compared to 2% of patients taking Lipitor. Going from 3 to 2 is indeed a drop by a third in relative risk, but the drop in absolute risk was only 1%, which sounds less impressive. This is common even in the medical literature. No surprise, since journal articles are often written by drug manufacturers. Now, the 3 to 2% Lipitor drop was over a period of only about 3 years. These drugs are to be taken over a lifetime, so the benefits accrue. Over 4 or 5 years, the absolute risk reduction might reach 1.3%. But you can see why many patients are not very moved. Even in the studies where people were presented with an idealized tablet with no side effects, more than a third stated that they would not consider taking a medication that would drop their 5-year absolute risk by 5% or more. Only about 50% of people would consider taking preventive medications that prolong their life by less than 8 months. The average expected longevity benefit from statins ranges from a few months to a few years, depending on risk. In this patient population here, the expected lifespan gain would be about a year, whereas here's the distribution of what people would want to take a drug every day for the rest of their lives. About a third said, 3 months? I'll take it. Whereas about 1 in 10 said they wouldn't take pills even if they got to live an extra 10 years or more. That's why it's such a personal decision, because we are all over the place in terms of what we're willing to accept. Your doctor may not care, though. Physicians were presented with the case of a man with a 7 to 10% risk of dying from cardiovascular disease over the next decade, who explicitly told the doctor that they only want to take a statin if it would increase their lifespan by a certain amount. Some doctors were told the patient demanded at least 8 years of life, and others were told the patient only asked for a matter of months, which is actually what they'd gain in real life. Yet 83% of doctors said they'd prescribe it to the patients who unrealistically demanded 8 years, which is almost exactly the same percentage recommended by the doctors who were told the patient only wanted a few months. In other words, the doctors were insensitive to patient preferences regarding survival gain. Now, for primary prevention, trying to prevent your first heart attack, no overall survival benefits have been found. Indeed, only 1 of 8 studies showed that statins actually made people live longer. But presumably, that's because the studies only lasted a few years, and for low-risk populations, the risk of dying from cardiovascular disease in that time may just be a few percent anyway. But such trials do show fewer events, heart attacks and strokes, so on a public health scale, it would make sense not to just wait for people to have a heart attack before starting them on cholesterol-lowering drugs. Critics counter that, yes, that sounds good, and if statins had these benefits without side effects, then perhaps the decision to start them is understandable. But look, Because statins increase our risk of diabetes, these drugs might give as many people diabetes as it does prevent them from having a heart attack or stroke. But the stat they cite is from a combination of primary and secondary prevention trials. In primary prevention trials, like trying to prevent your first heart attack, there is no increased diabetes risk. You only see that in secondary prevention trials, where people are trying to prevent their second heart attack, for instance. This might be because their risk of diabetes is higher in general, or they're using higher doses of statins. Intensive dose statin therapy is associated with a greater increased risk of new onset diabetes compared to moderate dose statin therapy. Of course, intensive therapy also offers more benefits in terms of cardiovascular protection. Then, if you separate out the primary prevention trials by the populations who have low or high rates of diabetes, regardless of the drug, statins only seem to increase risk among those with high baseline rates. Again, this could be a consequence of running shorter-term trials in low-risk populations. The big benefits, preventing death, may not show up, but the big downside, like the drug giving you diabetes, may also not show up. But even in the trials that do show increased diabetes, the risk of getting diabetes may be vastly offset by the cardiovascular protection offered from statin therapy. Of course, a healthy diet may reduce the risk of both at the same time, but sticking with the drug discussion before moving on to diet, increased diabetes risk is not the only side effect of statins. What about the risks to our muscles, liver, kidney, and brain? I'll get into all those next.